Bismillahi r-Rahmani r-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillahi hamdan kathiran tayyiban mubarakan fihi mubarakan alayhi kama yuhibbu rabbuna wa yirda. Jalla jalaluhu wa amma nawaluhu wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidil habib al-Mustafa sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa baraka wa sallama tasliman kathiran ila yawmiddin amma ba'd. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a number of hadith and narrations from him, we find that he spoke about a significant number of people that will, until the day of judgment, a significant number that will come one after the other, who will claim to be a prophet. Some to try to share prophethood with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and those were obviously people that arose at his time, and then there'll be others who will claim prophethood after him. He also spoke, the hadith actually says that there will be liars, kadhabun. Kadhabun means great liars, big liars, major liars. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in some hadith it says that they will claim prophethood. So we're going to look at some of these different hadiths and try to understand what is intended by those hadiths, so that we have a better idea. And also, one of the benefits of understanding this is to reinforce the concept, which is a very important concept in this ummah, the finality of prophethood, or khatmun nubuwa, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the seal of all prophets. We believe in all of the prophets that came. We don't know their exact number. We get an idea from a hadith of Imam Ahmad's, a hadith that's related by Imam Ahmad in his Musnad, that there were approximately 124,000 prophets from Adam alayhi salatu wasalam's time to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam's time. We don't know the details of each and every one of them, but our belief has to be in all of them in this general way, that whichever prophet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent, we believe in him. Some we know about and others we don't know about. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself was unique in the sense that he was considered to be the last of the prophets, as prophesied by some of the prophets before him. And he, as he himself said as well, in a number of different ways. For example, in one hadith he mentioned that it's like a building that has been constructed, a very beautiful building, and people go around it in, and they're admiring this building, and then they suddenly see that there's one place where a brick is missing. And he said that, "I am that final one brick to complete this structure." He said, "There is no prophet after me, la nabiyya ba'di." The other thing which was seen and witnessed by many of the Sahaba, and in fact it was also the cause and the reason for some of them becoming Muslim, was that he had the seal of prophethood, which was a small piece of protruding flesh between his blessed shoulder blades. That is something that was looked, that was inquired about, and it was something that was being pursued by, for example, Salman al-Farsi radiallahu an and others, because that was a sign that they had learned from their scriptures that this last prophet will have that seal of prophethood. And when they saw it, there was no doubt left anymore, and they embraced Islam as well. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in numerous different ways, he spoke about himself being the final prophet and that no prophet will come after him. But he did say that there will be imposters and there will be liars. There will be imposters and there will be liars. So for example, we have a hadith which is related by Imam Bukhari, one of the most authentic ones here, is that لا تقوم الساعة حتى تقتتل فئتان عظيمتان دعواهما واحدة وحتى يبعث دجالون قريب من 30 كلهم يزعم أنه رسول الله. So this hadith says that the last day will not occur until two major groups will not fight with each other. Both of their claims will be one. Both of their missions will be one. Both of them will be fighting for the same thing, but they'll be fighting with each other. That could apply to the fitna that we saw during the Battle of Siffin and the incident of the camel, which we spoke about in one of the earlier sessions. But that's not what we want to speak about today. We've already spoken about that. The next part of the hadith says, and until Allah until Dajjals will be sent. Dajjals will be sent close to 30. Now we know of only one Dajjal, the Antichrist, the main one. So what is this speaking about? What does it mean by close to 30 Dajjals? Well, here the word Dajjal is being used in its literal meaning. The word Dajjal comes from Dajjal, the one who does a lot of Dajjal, which is to really confuse and make things seem like something else, whereas they're something else. That's what Dajjal means, and that's one of the most significant things that the main Dajjal will do, which is to make things appear to be different than what they are and deceive people in that way. So people, when they lie, that's what they do. The reason why you lie or people lie is, I didn't do this or I did do this, whereas it's actually supposed to be the opposite. That's what lying is all about, is to normally tell a tale that is different from the reality. That's what lying is all about. So Dajjal is just an extreme form of that, and that's why Dajjal is called Dajjal. So this is a big liar. That's probably what you could say. So he said that it will be close to 30 Dajjals, 30 imposters, liars, and Dajjals. All of them, but in this one he says that these ones, كُلُّهُمْ يَزْعَمْ أَنَّهُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, that he is the messenger of Allah. Every one of them will claim to be the messenger of Allah. Imam Ahmad and Abu Ya'la have another hadith from Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, that this one, it says, between me and the day of judgment and the final day, there are 30 Dajjals Kadhabs, Dajjal and Kadhaban. In a hadith of Ali radiallahu anhu, which Imam Ahmad relates, and from Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu and Tabarani, there's a similar message in there as well. And in another one, it's a bit more particular. See, it's like the Prophet ﷺ probably mentioned this on a number of occasions. Sometimes he would mention it briefly. Oh, there's going to be close to 30. There's going to be 30. Then in this one, which is the hadith of Samurah, he says that the day of judgment will not come by until 30 liars, kadhab. In this one, he uses the word kadhab, will appear. The last of them, of these 30, this is an additional piece of information we're learning, the last of them will be the Dajjal, the A'war al-Dajjal, the one-eyed one. So he's also a Dajjal, but the reason why he's also a Dajjal is because he will also claim some kind of prophethood as well. Except when he sees, and many people will believe him, many people will believe him, until Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will come. When he realizes that Isa alayhi salatu wasalam is descending, this Dajjal will run, and he will go to close to Jerusalem, a place called Lud. And when Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will get there, Lud is where the international airport of Israel is. The Ben Gurion International Airport is in Lud. And when he gets there, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will be after Dajjal. Dajjal will see him and he'll tell his people that, quickly, make the sufu for salat, make the rows for salat. And when Isa alayhi salatu wasalam comes close, he'll say, salat time, come on, let's pray. And Isa alayhi salatu wasalam say, you liar, you're only doing this to deceive. And then he will kill him. So in this hadith, it says that he's the last one. Imam Ahmad Tabarani have related this, and it's mentioned, it's also related in Imam Tirmizi's book as well. In another one now, it's a hadith by Ibn Zubayr, that between me and the day of judgment are 30 liars, and out of them will be Aswad al-Ansi, the man of Sana'a, or the leader of Sana'a, and the Sahibul Yamama, the person from Yamama, and that is Musaylama. So in those two he gave the name. And you will see in here how the Prophet ﷺ is able to foretell things and prophesy things before they even occur. There's a hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, says that 30 liars or more. So then I asked, what is their sign? What is their sign? How do we discover that they're a liar? So he replied that they will come to you with a sunnah, with a way. Sunnah means a way. So the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is the prophetic way, the prophetic way to do something. But they will come with a way and a tradition that will be unlike the one you're on. So the one you recognize as the sunnah, they will come with something else, and that's how you recognize it. يُغَيِّرُونَ سُنَّتَكُمْ. They will change your sunnah and your way. When you see them, if you ever come across them, then make sure you abstain from them and keep away from them. In another hadith that's related by Tabarani from Abdullah ibn Amr, it talks about 70 dajjals, 70 kadhab, 70 liars. And this one is kadhab and it's 70. Numerous ahadith about this as well. Although Hafidh ibn Hajar al-Asqalani says that that particular narration is weak. Now, how do we, number one, how many are there? Dajjals, kadhabs, imposters, liars, what's it all speaking about? Let's try to make get a better understanding of this. So, for example, the hadith as related by Imam Ahmad from Hudhayfa with a good chain says that سَيَكُونُ فِي أُمَّتِي, in my ummah there will be كَذَّابُونَ دَجَّالُونَ سَبْعَةٌ وَعِشْرُونَ, 27 dajjals and kadhabs, big liars. And out of them there will be four women claimants to this lie and this, as imposters. وَأَنَا خَاتَمُ النَّبِيِّينَ وَلَا نَبِيَّ بَعْدِي, I am the finality, I am the seal of the prophets, and there is no prophet to be after me. So, when we see that there are the hadith about 30, that may be just kind of rounding off the 27 figure. Others have said that it is possible that when he's saying 30 and 70, he's just talking about a large number. You say 30, that's enough. It's a large number. Another way to understand this is that, because if you really count people who have made lies like this about things or the other, there's probably more than 30. So the way to understand this is that those who will have significant impact, who will have influence, meaning those claimants to prophet, because you get many crazy people on the street that will claim to be inspired or prophets or whatever, right? There's more than 30 of those. If you look in history, there's more than 30, because any crazy man on the street could be doing that every day. So I think the way the ulama have understood this is that if you take the hadith of 70, that takes it more generally. There's big liars. They're not necessarily going to claim prophethood. But those who will claim prophethood and who will be able to convince people of their prophecy, at least for a short time, and then people will follow them and they'll get a following, they will be 30. So when we say 30, it means people with some following, not just people who claim it and nobody believes them. Otherwise, anybody that calls to a way of misunderstanding, without saying we're prophets, but just saying we're Muslim, but this is not the right way, this is the right way. You know, you've got many people like that, like the Batiniyah, the Rafidah, the Hululiyah, all these people that think that maybe Allah's got a body. There's people who think that Ali was God, radiallahu anhu, Ali was supposed to be the Prophet. All of these people are liars. So when the Prophet ﷺ said there's going to be many liars, then it could refer to all of those people because they are lying in the deen. But they don't necessarily claim prophethood for themselves. Those that will claim prophethood will be how many? They will be about 30. And the last of them will be Dajjal. Dajjal won't only consider himself to be prophet, but he'll go beyond that as well, as some of these others did as well. Because it seems like it's some kind of intoxication for them to claim prophethood. It's a power kind of thing for them. And then when that's not enough, then they say, oh, we're even bigger than that. We're God. And that's and like one of them said that, you know, God is the one who enlivens people and I'm the God who kills people. One of them said that as well. So it's just this kind of fad and phase that these people go through, that it's some kind of a condition of theirs, maybe some kind of psychological condition or whatever, that gives them these crazy ideas. If you remember, during Ali radiallahu anhu's time, there was a person that he was dealing with from the Kharijites. His name was Ibn al-Quwa. We spoke about him. Ali radiallahu anhu said that you are from those liars. Now Ibn al-Quwa never claimed prophethood. So what Ali radiallahu anhu meant is that you're one of those liars that are calling to the wrong way because of your misunderstanding, and you're corrupting the idea of the deen to this other idea. Actually, he was not from the Rafidites. He was from them who loved Ali radiallahu anhu so much, went into an extreme level in their love for Ali radiallahu anhu, or for the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, now there's three famous ones that were dealt with by, two of them appeared in during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and one was dealt with in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the other two were dealt with during the time of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. In fact, there was a woman as well, so that's three people, and then there were a number of others as well. Now today, what we're going to look at, so the way is there's one is Aswad al-Ansi of the Ans tribe of Yemen. Then there's Musaylama from the Yamama, Banu Hanifa tribe. Then you've got Tulayha, but he actually became a good believer afterwards. Then you've got Sajah, who was a claimant to be a woman prophet, and she teamed up with another claimant first, and then she got married to Musaylama, because Musaylama managed to convince her. So although she was claiming to be prophet herself first, when she heard Musaylama was very articulate, he kind of set up the scene in such a way that he kind of seduced her in a sense. But that's something to be discussed afterwards. But alhamdulillah, she, right at then, she returned as well. And after that, there were a number of others. And then probably there's been so many more since then as well. So during the Abbasid time, and that there's been a number as well. We're going to look into only one of them today, which is Aswad, because he was there during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was dealt with during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then we'll look at the other smaller ones, and then inshallah next time we'll be dealing with Musaylama, Tulayha, and a few other of the larger ones. In the benefit of knowing about this is to know our history, to know what these people normally claim and why they would claim certain things, so that we can avoid these things, because we have problems in the current day as well, people who've claimed to be prophets, like we have the Baha'is and we have the Qadianis, the Ahmadiyya. So that's why it's important to know about these things. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was returning from Hajjatul Wada, if you remember, that was in the 8th or 9th year of Hijrah, the conquest was in the 8th. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had gone onto this farewell pilgrimage. After he came back, he didn't remain for too long in this world afterwards. Initially he became ill, and news spread about this. Then he became better, and then he became ill again, and then in that second illness, that was to be his terminal illness. So when the news spread of his illness first, two people claimed to be prophets. They thought this is a great chance. They'd seen the effect of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the influence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the following that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him, and because of that they probably felt that's a great way to do this. So two claimed to be prophets, but in their doing that, they did a lot of evil as well. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, while he was sick and in his illness, he was told about them. This was, if you remember, towards the end of his life, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had sent in to deal with the Roman army. He had sent the son of Zayd radiallahu anhu, Usama, at the head of an army, and Usama radiallahu anhu was very young. That army was prepared. It had gone out to the outskirts of Medina Munawwara, waiting to leave. And that's when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu had then let that army go, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had set it up with Usama radiallahu anhu at its head. So after he had done that, so this was really like towards the end, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had heard about these people. And there's another hadith in which it says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in this illness, came out of his room. He had a bandage around his head. He had something tied around his head, you know, because he was ill. And he remarked, he made a statement in front of everybody. He said that إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ فِي يَدِي سِوَارَيْنِ مِنْ ذَهَبٍ فَكَرِهْتُهُمَا فَنَفَخْتُهُمَا فَطَارَا. I've seen two gold bracelets in my hands. I dislike them, and when I blew on them, they flew away, they disappeared. So this is the dream that he's speaking about, or a vision he's speaking about, that this is what I've been shown, but when I blew on them, they disappeared, they vanished. I have interpreted this vision to be two liars and imposters, that I am between them. Two liars that I am in between. One is the one of Yemen, and the other one is of Yamama. Because they were on two different sides. Yemen was south. So this is where Aswad al-Ansi, very big man, very powerful man, very articulate in his speech, you know, very convincing, extremely inspirational in a sense, really big man with a very loud voice as well. He became an apostate. When he heard about the Prophet becoming ill, he became an apostate. And the other thing about this man is that he was very clever and he knew many magic tricks. So he could perform various forms of deceptive tricks that would convince people of things that he wanted them to be convinced about. He was a very wealthy man as well. He was a very wealthy man. And he used to do these strange things. So people would be very kind of deceived by him. And they would be convinced that he's whatever he's claiming to be. You know, when you get ignorant people and you get a person, a master of arts like this, then this is what he would do. Some narrations mention, some reports mention that he had two shaitans, jinn, that would bring him the news of the secrets of people from around the various different places. So when people would come to him, he would be able to tell them about things that nobody else knew except them. And they would be further deceived, and that would be enough to deceive them. What other reports say is that he actually had this large army of spies in the various different areas on his payroll or under his influence. They would come and give him all sorts of information. So he was a sucker for information. And whenever people would come to him, he'd know something or the other about them or their family or something. And then that would be really convincing for them. So Allah knows best exactly what it was. But anyway, he used to say that I've got these angels or whatever it is that he used to call them. They were shaitans. One was called Sahiq and the other one was called Shafiq. So he was a very sweet talker as well. He, as I said, he was probably a very influential and he was a very wealthy man. Initially, what he did was he took over. He already had an area of Yemen. He didn't have Sana'a. Sana'a was the capital, the big city, but he already had control over a small part of Yemen, which was on a corner of Sana'a. He was also called Dhul Khimar or Khammar. Some people say that it's because he used to drink a lot and he was always drunk. He used to really enjoy his drink. So that Khamar in Arabic means wine or intoxicants. Or Khimar means covering, shroud. He was always covered up. Whenever he would make a public appearance as a big man, you know, big heavy set, but he would always be covered up with some kind of hood or some kind of covering over his face. They say that he was very ugly and he was very dark. That's why Aswad al-Ansi, the black man of the dark man, was very dark, you know, unnaturally dark in the area. So very ugly as well. So he would always be covered up. Some say it's not Dhul Khimar but Dhul Himar. And all of these could make sense because he had a donkey who he had trained to follow certain orders. And the training that he'd given them was that he would say to it to sit, and it would sit. And it would, actually no, he would tell it to prostrate to Allah, to its Lord, and it would kind of go down into some kind of prostration. And then he would tell it to get up and stand for the Lord, and he would stand up. So when he would show that miracle to people, it was very strange. When he would show that this donkey's tricks to people, so he did things like that. That's why he was called a man of the donkey one. You have Yemen, which is in the south of the Arabian Peninsula. So Sana'a is kind of on the north northwestern side of it. Above that is a place called Najran. Now, if you know from the seerah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Najran is where, well, even Yemen at that time was under Christian rule because it was under an extension of the Roman Empire through Abyssinia, which was across the channel from there. Across the channel from Yemen in the south, there was Abyssinia. That was Christian, and Yemen was Christian as well. There were actually Persians they were part of the Persian Empire. Some of the remnants of the Persian Empire were there, and they were called the Abna. Abna means the children of these Persians. They had become Muslim afterwards. So at this point in time, the rulers there were supposed to be the Persians, the Abna, they call them. These people from Persian aristocracy, but they had become Muslim. Fayruz, Adaylami, and there were a few others. However, initially what happened with Najran, which is a bit in the north, they heard about Aswad, that he is this prophet or whatever it is. So they called, they sent somebody to him, and they called him to their area. He came, and those of them who'd be, some of them had become Muslim, some of them may have been Christian or whatever, they began to follow him. So they believed in what they saw. So he took from them 600 people, and then he went towards Sana'a. The leader of Sana'a decided that he needs to protect himself from this attack by Aswad al-Ansi. So Aswad has gone up north, taken people from Najran, coming back down south to take the main city now, Sana'a. The leader of Sana'a, he wanted to protect himself. So the person who was ruling, who was the leader of Sana'a at the time, was called Bazan. So they were actually originally under the Persian Empire, not the Roman Empire. I think I made a mistake. There was a Persian Empire. And he had been the governor under the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ, after they'd become Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ had said, okay, you will continue to govern Yemen. So Bazan died, and the Prophet ﷺ appointed his son Shahr to become the governor of Sana'a. So Shahr had, he decided that he'd rather go outside of Sana'a and meet Aswad on the way and fight with him outside. But Shahr had very few people. So when Aswad met them in battle, Aswad managed to destroy and to defeat Shahr. So they rode into Sana'a, and Sana'a came under Aswad. So the Muslims suffered a defeat. Shahr had a very beautiful wife who was now widowed. This Aswad al-Ansi, he forcefully took her under his command and forced her to become his wife. So she really hated him. Now he did this whole thing in about 25 days. Very fast he did this. After that he took a lot of the other areas of Yemen. So his influence was growing very fast. And he was spread quite far. So he had Najran and Sana'a now. Then after that, being a prophet wasn't enough for him. So he began to call himself the Rahman of Yemen, the most merciful one of Yemen. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had heard about him and said, we need to deal with him. So he sent Qais ibn Hubayrah to organize some form of movement there to take care of Aswad, because not only is he claiming to be prophet, but he's causing a lot of people to come away from Islam. So Qais went there. Now you have to remember, Aswad is a very informed person in the sense of what was going on. But it's Qais ibn Hubayrah managed to work underground, and he organized an underground group of people to overthrow Aswad. The thing is that there was another person called Fayruz there in Yemen, who was one of the Abna. So he was one of the original remnants of the original family that was supposed to be of the ruling class. And he had been disposed of, and Aswad didn't like him anyway. So they got a few people together. In fact, in some narrations he mentions that the Prophet ﷺ actually wrote letters to about 10 different people in the area, influential people that were not very happy, that you need to deal with. They were Muslims. So they were all trying to do something about it. So one of them was Fayruz Ad-Daylami. What Fayruz did was, he first managed to go and scope out this palace that Aswad used to live in. And this person was, Aswad was very protective over himself. So he had guards all over that place. Every room there was a guard, places, guards walking all over the place. It was very difficult. This woman that he had taken, she was a sister or a cousin to Fayruz Ad-Daylami. It was his cousin because she was from the same family. So he managed to get through to her and said, look, this is what's going on. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she had been Muslim as well. So this is what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has ordered, that we need to take care of him. So how do you suppose we can do this? She said, well, the whole place is bugged with soldiers. But there is one room that opens up outside, and it's kind of a broken down place, and you know, that's the only place that doesn't have anything in there. But how do we get into that? She said, well, I can leave you some weapons in there. You have to get in somehow, and you can take those weapons, then I can lead you to his room. So then he says, well, but how am I going to get in or something? So they plotted something that maybe send in somebody as a worker or something, and I will then hide him or something. So they made some very elaborate kind of plan. So Fairuz, he jumped over. He had everything planned with Qais, that Qais had to get everybody else ready outside, all the other Muslims ready outside of the city, that when the call would be made, they would rush in. So all of those that were very close to Aswad would be dealt with after Fairuz dealt with Aswad himself. So Aswad managed to scale a wall and get in. And the work, mashallah, it went according to plan. He got into that room and he found the weapons there as he had been told. And when he did that, there was a certain signal that they had to give, a certain sign that they had to give. So then the wife came out and she said that there is a guard here, but he's not here right now. He's going to be coming back. So she quickly took him to show him where Aswad's room was. He was next door to her room. So she stood by the door and Fairuz got inside. Now, Aswad at that time, Al-Anasi, was knocked out drunk, snoring in a very deep sleep. So Aswad managed to get in there. Sorry, Fairuz got in there and he struck him. When he struck him once, this guy woke up and the drunkenness all left him in the sign of this terror that, you know, his life is going to go. So all the drunkenness left him. And it says that he began to bellow like a bull, but he had been already struck the deadly stroke. So Fairuz finished him off, and some reports say that the woman came in as well and she struck him as well. She held his head until they finished him, until they severed his head. So he took his head off. Now obviously he was bellowing like a bull, they say. So the guards, they were quickly rushing to her. Now she quickly went to the door, and when the guards came, said, what's the matter with the Rahman of Yemen? So she said, shh, he's receiving revelation from Allah. He's receiving revelation from Allah. So the guard, he nodded knowingly. He's like, oh, okay, no problem. And he walked away. So anyway, they severed the head and managed to basically take this head of this massive body of his. And then he went outside and he jumped on the wall at Fajr time and he gave loud adhan. That was the sign for the other people to quickly come in. So that's when the Muslimin from outside, they began to rush inside. And in the meantime, the guards within, the guards and the men of Aswad were in great disarray and chaos because they didn't know what had happened properly. They saw their leader had been killed and so on. So when the Muslims were able to storm that place, many of them were killed, some ran away, and some came back to Islam. So that's how Aswad was dealt with. Now, as soon as this took place, the news hadn't reached Medina yet. You have to remember, it takes some time to reach Medina. So although Fairuz got the messenger off to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was immediately told by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Aswad had been killed. And he announced this to people. This was just before he passed away. Now the messenger that was sent from Yemen to tell the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam this good news, he got there days after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had passed away. But when he got there, he found that they had already known about this. So this was a prophecy that the Prophet ﷺ said that they've come out here, you know, before even getting news from anybody else. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned this in a hadith that they have appeared, Musaylama and Aswad. And when he was killed, he knew about it before the actual messenger came and told him it. The news bearer came and told him about it. In fact, it says that the Prophet ﷺ was told about him being killed a day or 5 days before he actually died. But they would not really know until the people would come back, The messenger would come and say, well, he died on this day. And they say, well, the Prophet ﷺ told us on this day. So it turned out that the Prophet ﷺ had actually informed them before it had actually occurred. So that's a clear prophecy of the Prophet ﷺ. Some say it was actually a letter that was sent, not a person. And that letter only was received in Medina 10 days after the Prophet ﷺ passed away. So Aswad kind of, his whole mischief was about for 4 months, very short-lived. Musaylamah's was longer, because it went into Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's time, and then Khalid bin Walid had to deal with him. But this Aswad al-Ansi, his was only for about four months or so. Then we had Musaylamah, and he had a few exchanges with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he finally agreed that, okay, let's have it half-half. You take care of half, I'll take care of half. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, despite his generous nature obviously, he said that if you ask me for this little stick or this little rope that's in my hand, I wouldn't even give you that. Because this was not about giving his worldly possessions over. This was about prophethood which Allah chooses. And then there was Tulayha ibn Khuwaylid al-Asadi. It's another one. But inshallah, we'll look at both of those in detail, along with the other one that claimed, the woman who claimed to be a prophet. We'll look at that later inshallah. But in order just to speak about the rest of them, just very quickly, another one was, if you remember, during the time of Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu an and his brother, he had to deal with Mukhtar during the time of Ibn Zubayr, who claimed certain things. Exactly what he claimed is kind of under doubt or under confusion, but that was another one. He used to write Al-Mukhtar Rasulullah, Mukhtar the Rasul of Allah, and he had some strange ideas. We dealt with that already. There was from Adi ibn Khalid says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that أُحَذِّرُكُمْ الدَّجَّالَيْنِ الثَّلَاثَ, I warn you of 3 Dajjals. Ya Rasulullah, you've already told us about the one-eyed Dajjal, who is the biggest of the liars. So who are these 3 that you speak about now? So he said that there will be a man from a people whose first and last people will perish, and upon them is the la'na of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they will be in a fitna called the Jarifa. So this Mukhtar was a Thaqafi, Hajjaj was a Thaqafi as well. And Asma radiallahu anha relates that from the Thaqif, 3 different types of people will appear. One will be the Kadhab, one will be a Dhayyal, and the Mubir. So one of them is speaking about the Kadhab, the Mukhtar. The other one is speaking about Hajjaj, which is who is this tyrant that will kill a lot of people. Then there's a famous poet, and his diwan, his collection, is actually studied for Arabic literature in many of the seminaries, madrasas, and other places as well. It's called Mutanabbi. But he actually made tawbah afterwards. So although he claimed something in the beginning, he made tawbah afterwards and he repented. Then there was another group that came out during the time of Banu Abbas, meaning the Abbasid time. One of them was during the time of Mu'tamid, and he was actually the leader of the fitna of the Africans. His name was Bahbud. He created a lot of chaos, a lot of bloodshed in Iraq, and he really liked to humiliate the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He used to think that he knew of the unseen. Then during the Khilafah of Muqtafi billah, there's a person called Yahya ibn Zikraway al-Kirmati. Then after that, his brother Hussein. And then came his cousin, his uncle's son. So this was like a family thing, whose name was Isa ibn Mahraway. And he called himself the Muddathir. So you know, it says in the surah says, Ya ayyuhal Muddathir, O the one who shrouded. Muddathir means the one who's covered, right? So he said, trying to prove himself to be proven from the Quran. Ya ayyuhal Muddathir. You know, like for example, it says in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya'ti min ba'di ithmuhu Ahmad. Ya'ti min ba'di ismuhu Ahmad. That after Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, the prophet that will come, his name will be Ahmad. So this Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani, he said that, look, this is the proof of my being the prophet, because it says, look, Ahmad, not Muhammad. Now, Ahmad was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's name from the maternal side. His mother's family had called him Ahmad. And his name from his father's side, meaning from his grandfather, was Muhammad. So he was referring to him, obviously. But this person tried to use that. And you'll see some of the ajib things that people will try to use. So there was a great scholar of India whose name was Maulana Ata'ullah Shah Bukhari. Ata'ullah, Ata means the gift of Allah. Ata'ullah Shah Bukhari. So he said, well, if you think that your name is in the Quran, Ata'ullah, Allah is in the Quran so many times, so am I going to call myself Allah? So these people, they will use different things to try to prove themselves. So he called himself the Muddathir, and that he was the one meant and intended by the surah, Ya Ayyuhal Muddathir, Qum Fa'anzir, stand up and go and warn the people. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he'd come back after his first revelation, he was shivering, and Khadija radiallahu anha had put this covering over him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fondly addressed him as the Muddathir and the Muzzammil. They were the second and third surahs to be revealed after Iqra Bismi, Rabbika Alladhi Khalaq. Anyway, this one, he managed to overcome some parts of Sham, and he also caused a lot of chaos there, and finally he was killed. Then another one came out during the Khilafah of Muqtadir, whose name was Abu Tahir al-Qirmati, and he's the one who actually took away the Hajar al-Aswad. We might talk about some of this afterwards in more detail, that he was the one who took the Hajar al-Aswad from the wall there. And you know that the Hajar al-Aswad was actually transported to Egypt for a while, and we'll talk about that later on. So he used to say, "Ana billah wa billahi ana yakhluqu al-khalqa wa ufnihim ana." So I am by Allah, and by Allah it is me. He creates the people, and I kill them, or I take care of them, meaning I finish them off. Then during the Khilafah of Radi Billah, Muhammad ibn Ali al-Shilqani, who's more popularly known as Ibn Abi al-Iraq, and he claimed actually not just prophethood, but he actually claimed to be to godhood, that he could actually bring the dead people to life. He was killed and hanged, and a number of his companions were also killed. So all of these are such that were not just single people claiming something, but they actually had a small following as well. Then during the Khilafah of Muti' Billah, there was a group of Tanasukhiyya, and in among them there was a young man who claimed that Ali radiallahu anhu's ruh had transmigrated into him. So Tanasukhiyya, meaning they are believers in Tanasukh. Tanasukh means transmigration, or what the Hindus will call reincarnation in a sense, but it's more transmigration, the ruh coming into somebody else. There are people who believe that nowadays as well, reincarnation. That when a person dies, this is their belief. Some of these Buddhists believe that as well, that when people die, that we are, our ruh is somebody else, we just come in the form of something. So if it's an evil person, it means he did evil in the life before, so that's why he's come in an evil form, or they come in the form of an animal. So they believe in this kind of transmigration. So this person had a very exotic idea of that. He said that the ruh of Ali radiallahu an came into him, so transmigrated into him, and his wife used to claim that the ruh of Fatima radiallahu anha transmigrated into her. Then there was another one who claimed that he was Jibreel alayhi salam. So it looks like they would like turn the pages of history and the Sharia, and they would say, oh, Jibreel sounds nice. You know, Ali radiallahu anha, Fatima sounds nice. Many people have claimed to be prophet, so we'll do this one now. You know, that might work. All of these were beaten, and they obviously, the whole point of the first two, meaning the one who used to think about that the ruh of Ali and Fatima, that couple, they obviously were trying to get a praiseworthy position as being family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But because they were probably not from his family, they tried to say that he had transmigrated into them. Mu'izzud Dawlah dealt with them. During the Khilafah of Mustadhir Billah then, which was in 499, another man appeared in the outskirts, or in the furthest areas of Nahawand, and he claimed prophethood, and there was a group of people that followed him as well, but he was also taken care of, he was killed as well. Then there was another group of people that appeared in the Maghrib, in the western part of the world, you know, in North Africa, both men and women. So one of them, he called himself La, a perfect name. The reason is that, you know, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it says which has أنا خاتم النبيين ولا نبي بعدي. I am the خاتم النبيين. Wala, la is negative, that there is no nabi ba'di after me. So he's saying la nabiyun ba'di, la is the nabi after me, because the la, we're using it as a negative, as a negating particle. They're saying no, na is a noun, la is a noun. It means it's talking about this man, la. So he is the nabi after me. Now the thing is that you got ignorant people. I mean, you know, we're laughing about this today, but imagine the people that followed them. There must be a reason why people follow. For example, Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani, one of his very famous followers, was a major scientist that achieved the Nobel Prize. So it's really not about how clever you are. Your cleverness and your intelligence and your genius and your mental acumen needs to be tempered with the spirit of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with spirituality. Otherwise, that prowess you have, mental prowess you have, doesn't really, if it's not guided, because at the end of the day, the aql is only good if it's guided aright. Because it's raw logic, can take you anywhere. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from all forms of deviances. Yeah, so he was called La, and his support was from the hadith, La Nabiya Ba'di. That's what he used to use. Then there was another one, whose name was Fazari. He was a magician. He lived in Malaqa. In Arabic it's called Malaqa, which is basically Malaga in southern Spain, Andalusia. So now this is during the Andalusian times. Abu Ja'far ibn Zubayr was sent to Granada, but this man was from Malaga. So Malaga is a bit of a distance from Granada. But this Fazari was sent as an advocate on behalf of the Emir of Granada. No. Of the Emir of Malaga to Granada. And that's where Abu Ja'far ibn Zubayr coincidentally met him. So Abu Ja'far managed to kill him, and also with him was another woman that claimed to be Prophet as well. What she would say is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, La Nabiyya Ba'di. There's no male Prophet after me. If you really want to translate Nabiyun as male, because it's not feminine, it's actually male gender. So it doesn't preclude la nabiyyata ba'di. I'm a nabiyyatun. Now in Arabic, you add a ta marbuta, and that becomes feminine. So sahir means magician, sahira means a female witch or magician. So she's saying that the hadith says la nabiyya ba'di, there's no male prophet after me, it doesn't preclude their female prophet. So that's what her claim was. So, you know, you could use the Sharia to whatever you want if you really want to. You could use the verses of the Quran to support some deviant ideology you have. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah will raise certain people through the Quran and put other people down through the Quran as well. Because they may use the Quran in the wrong way to justify certain things. So, I mean, this is about 27 that we can count until that time. And then the world has continued since then as well. So it's really difficult to decide, because what the Prophet ﷺ had in mind, how big will these kadhabs be? How much influence they'll have? You know, he obviously had something in mind, but nobody asked him exactly, can you tell us how many followers they'll have? How much influence they'll have? So there's always going to be that, but what he said is there's going to be 30, so there's definitely going to be 30. Then after that, if you look beyond that, there's people who've claimed to be other things, not prophet, but the next best thing to do after that is to claim Who is supposed to be coming? Mahdi and Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. So there's people who claim to be Mahdi, and there's people who claim to be Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And Qadiani, he claimed first to be Mahdi, then Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And then when his grandson, who was one of the recent leaders, when he was asked that, we know that if, as you say, that he was Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, meaning he's the promised prophet after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, if Isa alayhi salatu wasalam is to come, we also know that Dajjal is supposed to come as well. So if you're claiming that your great-grandfather was the next prophet, Isa, so his name was Mirza Ghulam Hadkani, but he called himself Isa at one time as well. So if you're claiming that he is the one who's supposed to come, then where is the Dajjal gone? So I remember hearing a clip of this. His response was very clever. He said, well, the eyes that have not recognized him as Jesus will not recognize the Dajjal in his true form either. Dajjal has also come and gone, and you've missed both of them. So yes, there's a lot of people who've claimed to be Mahdi, and then there's also people who've claimed to be Sahabis. Well, this was earlier on, obviously, that they said, oh, we've seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or whatever. So there's always going to be claimants like that. But alhamdulillah, we are very fortunate that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, unlike in other religions, in this religion, they have left clear-cut proofs, warnings, prophecies, and proper information that will help those who have at least a bit of information about the faith to be able to recognize this. Now you're thinking that when we speak about Dajjal, why is Dajjal going to be one of the worst fitnas that you will be dealing with? The reason is that according to some narrations, it mentions that before he will actually appear, people would have stopped speaking about him. So people will be ignorant about him. So when he will come, there will be a lot of ignorance. And it says that the women will be very ignorant of that time from the deen. And that's why the men will have some amount of understanding if they're pious. But the women will be more ignorant. So when his fitna will come and he will be doing his shows and exhibitions or whatever, they will want to go out. And the men will have to stop them because the fitna will be so great. So that's why it's very important to know about it. All of the narrations and the guidance are there, and we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and may Allah bless Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that He's left us this information so that we can lead successful lives and at least avoid these major pitfalls. So inshallah, next week we'll look into more depth about Musaylama and Tulayha and a few others, because there was a lot more detail about their problems with Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu than Khalid bin Walid. So inshallah we'll look at that in more detail next time. But you can see how there's a statement in Arabic which says that لِكُلِّ سَاقِطَةٍ لَاقِطَةٌ. For anything that is being dropped, somebody is there to pick it up. So if it's something valuable, there's going to be more people to pick it up. Something less valuable, there will still be somebody to pick it up. At the end of the day, somebody who has nothing, or somebody wants to go and recycle it, there'll be somebody that wants to pick something up that's been dropped. So with any ideology, you think, how can somebody believe that? But there will be people who are of a lower, brain cell count, lower guidance, they're depressed and, they need something to hold on to, and this person gives it to them. Because what Musaylama did was, when he married that woman, and her people said, well, you didn't give any mahr to her, you didn't give any dowry to her. So the mahr is, no more asr prayer for you guys. You don't have to make asr salat anymore. And the way he managed to get a lot of followers was that he said, okay, wine is permissible for you now. So he made certain things permissible. Once you do that, and you show a few things here and there, then there's the lax ones, they'll take you on. But Allah protect us. اللهم أنت السلام ومنك السلام تبارك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير اللهم يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث اللهم يا حنان يا منان لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين جزى الله عنا محمد ما هو أهله جزى الله عنا محمد ما هو أهله جزى الله عنا محمد ما هو أهله اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا وعافنا واهدنا وارزقنا اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا ولمشايخنا ولأساتذتنا ولطلابنا ولإخواننا ولأخواتنا ولأصدقائنا ولأولادنا ولأزواجنا ولكل من له حق علينا ولكل من أوصانا بالدعاء اللهم اغفر لهم وارحمهم وعافهم واعف عنهم اللهم اشف مرضانا اللهم ألف بين قلوب المسلمين اللهم ألف بين قلوبهم اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا اللهم أصلح ذات بيننا اللهم وفقنا لما تحبه وترضى من القول والعمل والفعل والنية اللهم أرشدنا في الأمور كلها اللهم أصلح لنا شأننا كله ولا تكلنا إلى أنفسنا طرفة عين اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه Oh Allah, allow us to see the truth as the truth and to follow it and to see the wrong as the wrong and allow us to abstain from it اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من الشك في الحق بعد اليقين Oh Allah, protect us and we seek your refuge from doubt after you have given us conviction اللهم ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب ربنا إنك جامع الناس ليوم لا ريب فيه إنك لا تخلف الميعاد اللهم ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين وجعلنا للمتقين إماما اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في الدين والدنيا والآخرة اللهم إنا نسألك اللهم إنا نسألك الرضا اللهم إنا نسألك الرضا اللهم ارزقنا حبك وحب من ينفعنا حبه عندك اللهم ألهمنا رشدنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا اللهم ألهمنا رشدنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا اللهم طهر قلوبنا من النفاق وأعمالنا من الرياء وألسنتنا من الكذب وأعيننا من الخيانة فإنك تعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور اللهم انصر المسلمين في كل مكان اللهم انصر إخواننا في سبيلك اللهم انصرهم اللهم انصرنا اللهم احفظنا من البلاء والآفات والمحن اللهم جنبنا الفواحش ما ظهر منها وما بطن اللهم اكفنا بحلالك عن حرامك وأغننا بفضلك عمن سواك ربنا رب اجعلنا مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتنا ربنا وتقبل دعاء ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم رب زدنا علما نافعا ورزقا واسعا وعملا متقبلا وشفاء من كل داء اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع وقلب لا يخشع ونفس لا تشبع وعين لا تدمع ودعاء لا يستجاب له اللهم اجعل آخر كلامنا لا إله إلا الله سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله.
The point of a lecture is to encourage people to act, to get further, an inspiration, an encouragement, persuasion. The next step is to actually start learning seriously, to read books, to take on a subject of Islam and to understand all the subjects of Islam, at least at their basic level, so that we can become more aware of what our deen wants from us. And that's why we started Rayyan courses, so that you can actually take organized lectures on demand, whenever you have free time, especially, for example, the Islamic Essentials course that we have on there, the Islamic Essentials Certificate, which you take 20 short modules. And at the end of that, inshallah, you will have gotten the basics of most of the most important topics in Islam, and you'll feel a lot more confident. You don't have to leave lectures behind. You can continue to leave, to listen to lectures, but you need to have this more sustained study as well. Jazakallah khair, and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.